Hi everyone, my name is Charu Hariharan. I'm really happy to be hosting the percussion discussion today for the wonderful Gappu Cajon and Percussion Industries. Gappu is an instrument, sorry, is a brand that I endorse. I endorse the cajon and I've been playing the instruments for a long time. Gappu is one of the very few, as I've already spoken about Gappu in the percussion discussions before, Gappu is one of the very few percussion industries based out of India producing some amazing instruments. Please do check out their instruments from their website. You can find the website and the details in the Instagram channel. And also, today we are having an amazing percussionist along with us. I come from the South Indian tradition. My main instrument is the mridangam. So I would be more than excited to speak to Swaminathan Selvaganesh today, who is an amazing khanjira player, a percussionist, and a great musician hailing from a lineage of musicians. And everyone would know about Sri Vikku Vinayak Ram sir, about Selvaganesh sir. He comes from the same family. He's a son of Selvaganesh sir. So please do check out the Gappu instruments. Just visit the Instagram page of theirs and you can find the link in them. And you will find some amazing percussion instruments about the artists who endorse Gappu and about what all instruments they make and details like that. Okay, I see people are joining one by one. And I've also seen Swami is here. And before we get into the conversation with Swaminathan, I would also like to mention that all the percussion discussions are available as podcasts on all the streaming platforms, including Spotify, iTunes, and all the streaming platforms. So also on YouTube. So please do check out the percussion discussions. And yeah, I can see more people joining. Really happy to be seeing that the live is actually on and there are people listening to us. So without much delay, let me invite Swaminathan into the conversation. There's so much to know, so much to discuss. And I hope you all know about the instrument khanjira, but here is an expert, an exponent from the field who would be able to throw more light about the instrument and about his lineage and tradition. So let's just welcome Swami.
Hi.
Hi, Swami.
How are you?
Fine. Good to see each other.
Yeah. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yeah. Absolutely audible. Are you able to listen to me as well?
Yes. Absolutely.
Great. How are you?
I'm doing good. And how are you?
Doing music.
Yes. I started traveling now, you know, like after this great situation. It's been slowly, everything is picking up. So, yeah, that's what I'm having.
Interesting. So I'm extremely happy and stoked to have you here in the conversation. We have known each other just by names and also by all our acquaintances, but never got a chance to meet you. I'm so looking forward to this. And especially after the phone call that we had, that there was so much to know about your instrument, about your legacy, about little techniques that, you know, we never know as people who are listening to music of how much of detailing goes behind just one instrument, every stroke, every part of the instrument. So before going much about, speaking more about khanjira, how did you get to khanjira? We all know about the lineage, of course, Vikku Vinayak Ram sir, such an important part of the entire Indian music lineage, in fact. So he plays ghatam. Of course, your father, Selvaganesh sir, plays khanjira. So you had options to choose between, you know, there are vocalists in your family. There are people who play mridangam and khanjira and ghatam. What drew you to khanjira, actually?
So before getting into that, I'm so happy to be a part of this discussion being conducted by Gappu Cajon. And I'm so happy that you are here to discuss with it. I'm like,
my pleasure.
With you. And then, yeah, like you said, we've been knowing each other by names. And like my dad also told me about how you met him. And yeah, it's all there. But it's so good finally that we are doing this. So like you asked, like I had like so many options to choose any instrument. Yeah. So initially what happened is like my grandfather, he started teaching me with mridangam. You know, like in our school, whoever comes, like if they had any preferences, we would directly go with that instrument. Otherwise, we give mridangam on the first. And then like like every month we kind of used to do a program from our school to different people, like a
Okay.
demonstration. So in that time, like each student will be given turns with the different instruments. Like for this demonstration, someone is doing mridangam, and the next demonstration he'll be doing katam and kanjira, like that. And then finally, like according to the ants, like, and then their interest on it, my grandfather says, like, you do this, you do that. So
Okay,
like
okay.
that, I started with mridangam. And then like we had like a preliminary, intermediate and final exams in our schools. So I did my
Oh, okay.
preliminary exam in mridangam. Like we invite any artist to come and conduct the exams with the portions and things. So I did mridangam initially, but later what happened, like in one demonstration I was playing kanjira, and at that
Okay.
point of time I was thinking, like, oh, kanjira is so easy to play. I mean, like, and also to carry. Mridangam, like a small guy, when I used to keep it in my leg, I feel pain, and just I lift it and keep it down sometimes. So it's like I thought, like, okay, mridangam is pretty different, difficult for me. And also it has different placements, right? Like nam, din, cha. I was like,
Absolutely.
at that point of time, I was like, oh, this is like very tough. But when I started playing kanjira, I felt like, okay, there's only like two placements basically and two fingers doing the job. I was like, okay, fine, then I
What was
should
your age
try.
at that point? Because if mridangam should feel heavy on your lap, you should be
Like
very young at that point.
6, 7, like kind of that
Ah,
time.
okay.
So I was like, okay, fine. Then I started playing kanjira, and then I went to my tata and I asked him, like, I want to learn kanjira, not mridangam.
Okay.
He was like, why did you want to choose kanjira? I didn't tell him
Okay.
that I felt this is easy. That would have been like, he would have scolded me, like, what are you saying? You have to do work hard, you have to practice hard to do something. I was like, simply just escaping, I told him, like, no. I saw my father playing, and I was like, I want to become like him. I like this playing really. But that's also true, incident. Like, I like this playing, and then I was like inspired from him a lot. But initially, I said, like, that is the only reason I'm changing. He said, okay, fine,
Okay.
then you take Kanjira. But later, like getting into like a deep training and like in the advanced stages, then I realized like my perspective was totally wrong. It's like
Yeah.
whatever you people and you guys doing in two hands, like in mridangam, we have to bring
Yeah.
it in kanjira in one hand. Like like even though
Yeah.
it's not like similar sounds, but still the same, like circle and all those things, you have to play it like in
Absolutely.
one hand. I was like, okay. But that point of time I was really in love with my instrument. I was like, okay, fine, this is like adventure to me, like, and I felt this is my passion, this is where I belong maybe. So I was like, then I went deep into the kanjira.
Absolutely. Wow. And by what time did you actually start professionally training Kanjira? Because the size of the instrument, your hand, everything matters when it comes to a Kanjira, right? Like the ability to hold it, it's not easy as a child. So at what time did you start actually
So
training?
it's like, I took Kanjira at the age of 7, if I'm not wrong, like 7. But the deep training is like around 8 and 8.5 years, like I started really into that. But like training has been not really like training. It's like I'm being born in this beautiful family full of musicians. So wherever I turn, like this, like we used to live like all together, my uncles and everyone, we used to live together as like one big family. So it's like whenever I go into one room or other, someone will be teaching someone else something, and or something practicing, rehearsing. It's like wherever I go, I hear a lot of music in it.
It's
So
like a
it's like,
24/7 university. It just keeps going and going, right? Everywhere it's music.
so
Yeah.
I felt like I've been growing up with music and listening, and suddenly it's like not, I don't have like a proper class timings. It's like suddenly I go somewhere and my tata comes, okay, come here, learn this, learn that. It used to be like that in those days, right? Like it's like
Yeah.
a guru, like once you go into your guru's place, you have to be with him. You never know when you're gonna get some corvée or some circuit to practice. That's how I initially
Exactly.
started, and I would say like more I like learned more on stage than off stage, like. So my tata also was busy in traveling. So he just like take me to wherever he goes, and he makes me to sit next to him on the stage and listen. Sometimes also he asked me to, okay, play now. I was like, what? It's like, play whatever you play. So
Do I
it's
actually
like
see your father join the conversation? I am so honored to see him here. So, so happy. Yeah. Yeah.
So
Sorry, sorry,
yeah,
Swami.
so
Continue. Yeah.
No, absolutely. So that's how it's been, like not really like like proper timing of learning. It's like I've been learning all day, all time, like never know. You just call me sometimes and just teach me
Yeah.
everything.
Great.
So like I was saying, on stage experience was like the most I learned than off stage. Not just like the lessons, also how you react on stage, how you like catch up what's happening and then just take your space and also not overdoing it. So like
Yeah.
everything on stage experience learning from my grandfather was totally different than, you know, like off stage experience.
What did he actually teach you? Like, does he actually let you perform and then correct you? Or let he
It's mostly
how is
like
the
that.
method of teaching? Okay.
So like he's after teaching me lessons, that's different. But on stage experience is like you just play. Like I've been listening to him, so it's like more than teaching, is listening and learning from that. So on stage suddenly he tells me to play something. It's like different taram, I don't know what it is. And then suddenly I do mistakes and then coming back to home, he was like, okay, you did this. Instead of that, you can do that. Like you were short of two matra in that. That's okay. Next time you just add more two more matras in that. So you
Wow,
know, like
wow.
it's kind of correcting mostly.
Wow. Okay. And how is the difference in tutelage from your dad? Because he's someone who actually we just spoke about the technique that he developed for the Kanjira and how he customized Kanjira for his own playing, his own sound, and how you were developing the same as well. So how was it, for example, your Tata or grandfather would have taught you the skills in terms of construction, composition, about the lineage, about the, you know, about the sound of percussion or rhythm rather. But the education regarding the technique comes from your father, right? So how was the interaction with your father and how is it different from Tata?
Like you said, Tata has been like teaching me like lessons and like, you know, like the way of doing it like that. But from my father, I learned the techniques and technicality on the Kanjiras and, you know, his own new techniques he implied in that, so that it makes like much easier and also sounds really good, you know, like, and you can play along a lot of things. For example, so in Kanjira, if you take it, like there are like only two placements, two sounds initially. Like one is open, another one is closed. Like, you know, like holding this,
Yeah.
if you close, like, of course, you know, I'm just explaining for the people
No,
who are
please, please,
listening.
please. I'm as naive as anyone. I'm just playing whatever I can, that's all. So I would love to know more.
So it's like when you keep it open, that's open sound, and then when you lock it and play, that's a closed sound. So these are the only two sounds, and also these are the two like fingering
Movements.
placements to play.
Three and one.
Exactly. So like I would say three sounds, like ta ta dum, three sounds. So dum is usually played in the lower part of the ganjira, and also holding the ganjira is like inside, you keep it like this, and then
Okay.
here you hold it like this.
Just one second. So that we can join together. I did have an instrument with me.
All right.
So, yeah. So, do you have the symbol towards you, right? That's how you hold it.
Towards, so that's how you get more sound of jingle. If you hold it like this, you hear the more of the skin. So
Yeah.
together it's like, if you keep the jingle towards you, that's much better. And one second.
You're trying to tune it?
No, I'm just taking this kanjira off,
Oh,
more
okay.
the traditional
Wow. Nice, okay.
one. So that's it. One second. Let me get some water.
Yeah.
Tune. So the sound is like that
Yeah.
temperament, you know, like that tone. But if I apply some water and to get
So
some
water is
nice
what you use to ink, I mean, for the general audience who
strength.
are introducing to the instrument for the first, water is what you use to increase and decrease
Bring
the
it down.
bass. Yeah.
So it's like if you want like more low ends, you'll add more water. If you want the high ends, like you'll just keep it, you know. So now that's how it is. It was like this before. When I apply
Yeah.
water and it's like going down.
Yeah.
So coming back to this, like holding it, like I usually keep, you know, these lines, I rest them on the kanjira. So it's not too much in or too out. So it's easy
Yeah.
for the dom open and release actions.
Yeah, like this thing.
So
Nice.
dom usually is played like this. But my dad felt like we can also play dom like this.
Oh, so
So it's like dom is same. You
nice.
only have to like practice hard so that your little finger gets, you know, better, like same like this.
Oh,
But this is like
interesting.
little heavier because we always play it like this, and this is like little strong, but this one is not very
Yeah.
strong. But once you get practice to it, it will get strong better.
It's just like how we spoke on the call. It's like a tam, right? Like a
Yeah,
half chap,
tam, yeah.
arachap.
Arachap, yeah, like a charm, charm.
Yeah.
So, like,
Interesting.
playing strokes are like that dit takadum. That dit
Yeah.
takadum, that dit takadum, that dit takadum, that dit takadum. But when we say it's like tat tak kedadum, tat tak kedadum, tat tak kedadum. Now this tat tak kedadum, I can also play like.
Oh.
So
Wow.
that dome. So you can like, you
Wow.
know, you, so there's no any more limitations to play more around that, you know, like going much speeder and things. It's much easier and also sounds really, you know, like good. So that's one
Off.
thing that I learned from him. And also the tuning, the Kanchira.
Yeah.
So mostly people would keep it like, you know, like not high and not low, but in the middle, somewhere in the middle, like mid tones more. But my dad is like, he felt like he needed little more bass, like, you know, to give it little more bass. Into that, he added bass, and I like too much of bass. He's like, he has like
Okay.
his limit of bass, and but I have like my little more. I just dig deeper. So,
Have you made any difference in the size? Because, for example, if you have a larger diameter, you get a larger bass as well. Have you changed the
yeah,
dimensions
so
of the
the
Kanjira?
okay, that's a good question. Like, I use the smaller ones, if you see,
Oh, okay.
it's like. These are like little smaller, and it's also like, you know, my hands are pretty large, you know, but my dad's are like
Yeah.
little short. So it's like I
Okay.
always tell him that your hands are made for Kanchira. It's like it's so
Okay.
cute, and the way if you see him playing, it's like close and it's like
Yeah,
all cute in it.
correct.
Lots of cuteness in it. So I'm trying to get that cuteness, but still. So my
Okay.
Kanchiras are a little small. But there are like bigger diameters. I prefer the smaller ones so that I get more low end. The more it goes like, you know, big, you get less of low ends.
Who is it?
Yeah, that's how I felt.
Oh,
So
okay.
like, so that's why I always use the smaller ones. And it's also like, you know, smaller, so it's like you can play more around it. And
Okay,
also other thing,
because
my father says like, so in Kanchira, like wherever you play, you're gonna get like. It's like you can play here or here, it's gonna be the same. So he tells me always to, this is the play area, like his
Okay.
style. It's like this is the play area. So like going back and forth with dom and ta, it's not very far, and you can travel. You know, you can play faster. You don't have to go like instead of going that. So like the travel between
Okay.
ta and dom is like not that far that you can go faster. So that's
Wow.
one of his advice and technique do it.
Wow. It's like a master class for all of us, in fact. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Pleasure.
This also brings me to who is your inspiration with Kanjira? Do you also observe other artists in Kanjira? Because you have a master at home. But
Yeah.
there have been Acharya masters like Hari Shankar sir. There are so many current players also who are exemplary, like Guru Prasanna or Shri Sundar Kumar
Right,
sir,
Shri Sundar
Purushottaman sir, so many
Kumar,
of
Purushottam
them.
sir, yes.
So yeah. So anything that you observe from other Kanjira players, like what is your take or how do you listen to them?
So initially, I never heard anything out of my dad or my grandfather. It's like been I've been being with them and like traveling with them all the time. Even at my
Yeah.
childhood, when my tata used to take me everywhere, so I was just listening to their music and, you know, like being fully into that. But later, like once I started playing concerts and then, you know, like started traveling, I started to listen like wherever I go, I hear like people playing it, and it's like everyone is amazing. Like all the
Yeah.
Kendra players, I would really say hats off to them. It's like because they are doing everything in one hand. Even if you say like other instruments, single-handed instrument like pandeera, other things, they use two hands to play on this. Like even frame drums,
Exactly.
everything. They use two hands to play on this, but only Kanchira players, they use like only one hand, and this hand is just like to control the tones and the open and
Exactly.
close.
Yeah.
So it's
Because
like
I think
pretty
people
amazing
watching
job
it
that
wouldn't
everyone
know
has been trained
about
in that.
People watching wouldn't
Exactly.
probably know
And even
about
it was,
Kanjira.
True, true. And also, like, more like, I heard it from different people in a like they had a very wrong judgment about it. It's like, okay, Kanjara is like just you get it's like a drum, it doesn't have sur like Mridangam, Gadam, or any other instrument. In like, my father always says only tabla and Kanjara are the two instruments that doesn't have sur in South India, South Indian
Yeah.
instruments, classical instruments. These two doesn't have any pitch or sur. So people like it's okay, like it's okay, it's good, but it can't be like a mainstream. But come on, this is like a total package. You have low ends, you have high ends.
Everything.
Yeah, except for the pitch also, it has everything else. And the
I mean,
other,
but pitch,
like, I've got
you
it.
can tune to pitch. You also play in pitch. If you want to sustain a pitch, it's like tuning
I
with
can
your
do
left
that.
hand. You know, you can
Yeah.
sustain in that pitch also.
Right. I can also imitate like a bass guitar. Yeah, you can do that. It's like a whole package. And one more like amazing thing about this instrument is like, since it doesn't have any sur or pitch, it goes with anything. Like literally any
Yeah.
music or any form of thing, it really blends into that. That's one
Yeah.
major advantage of this instrument. And so I felt like later started collaborating with different people around the world. Like I
Yeah.
don't have to ask them what pitch is the song. Come on, in our Carnatic music, it's like we have one pitch and the whole concert will be for the same pitch.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. So, but in Western classical or Western music, sometimes they have key change in one song itself, and they have like different songs in different keys. So imagine if I have to like if my instrument has a pitch or something, I have to carry so many instruments for so many songs and so
Absolutely.
many
Yeah.
things. So I mean, come on, that's the one major thing. It's like, so whoever calls me to play a jam, I just take my instrument and go. I don't have to know what pitch they're gonna play. I just want to
Yeah.
know what signature they're gonna play. That's all I need. So I'm getting a hi from Rajesh Vaidya. Now, hi,
Yeah, I
sir,
was just
for
about to
joining us
say,
here.
hi, sir. Really, really happy to be seeing you here. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah, such a pleasure, people watching, you know, masters like
Yeah.
him watching the show.
True.
Yeah, and you also spoke about the jingle, which was very interesting to me. Yeah, could you share?
So sure. I'm just looking if I have a normal jingle with me to explain why we are using this one.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, I have a couple of coins in mind, which
Can you show me
is
that? Okay.
they are Indian 50 paise coins in my Khanjira.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, which
I
will be
mean,
different
it's
from
kind of
yours.
similar to what I'm using also. It's like a little small, but people used
Yeah.
to have, like a bigger diameter one, like a coin, bigger coin,
Yeah.
which has like a very thin resonance, thin sound to it. But what my dad and me uses, this is like Japanese 5 yen coin.
Oh, interesting. Oh, it's thicker.
It's like, yeah, a little thicker, but it's smaller as well. It's like
Yeah.
thicker than that one, and then it's like smaller. And one sec, a little. Okay, I don't have the other single anyway. So this
It's, yeah.
5 yen coin, we have like three or four jingles according to the size of the kanjira.
Oh, okay.
And I really get like I don't get the thin sound. So when I play, it's like it's not dominating, and also it's not like very low. But if I have like the bigger jingle, it will be like chick, chick, it's like like the thin resonance. I wouldn't say that
Yeah.
that's bad, but for my style of playing, like the sound which I love to create, I like this kind of coin. Because I've been like I said before, I've been watching my dad for so many years and listening to him. That
Yeah.
sound is like the sound I wanted to have with little more bass, like I told you.
Yeah. And it stands out completely. And this also brings me to this wonderful album that you did with your father, I think in 2018. I just found it on Spotify and I happened to listen to the Chennai Matrix, if I'm not
Chennai
wrong.
Matrix. Yeah,
Yeah,
that one.
the Khan Journey duo. Is that right?
Yeah. Yes, exactly
It
that.
was. Yeah, it
So,
was beautiful. And the sound of the Kanjira, because you were speaking about that, it stands out compared to whatever we hear as Kanjira for concerts or whatever recording. Your father's as well as your instrument stands out so much. Speak a little about that album, actually. It's a
Yeah.
beautiful, yeah.
Sure. So before getting into the album, let me explain to you like how we started doing this solo kind of thing, like duo Panchira. So in the north, like you know, there have been a tradition of like tabla duets happening, father son duet happening. So my father always say like he inspired from Ustad Zakir Hussain ji and his father Ustad Allah Rakha ji. So they do like a duo like no one can, you know, like beat that. It's like this amazing duo thing happening. So my dad always like looking at them wanted to do something like that. So he's been doing with his father and my father have been doing that for a long time. Now that I also like into the stream and playing with them, he really wanted to have that kind of feel and thing happening between us, me and my dad. So we started to do that, like a duo thing on the concerts. So whenever, usually before that, we used to do solos, like whenever we get solo, each one take rounds and each one do it. But me and my dad, we started doing like a solo together, doing a duo. So we take, you know, like he takes some phrases and me, like I'm just following it. It's not like a korappu, I would say, but it's more like experimenting on one phrases or something. If he takes a three fives and you know, like threes and fives, like 1 2 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5 1 2 3 4 5. So taking that four threes and four fives, we try to, you know, like move around and permutation and combination different things, and then we come to one core where we play together and nadis and different things, lot of that. So and we started doing that, and we touch wood had a, like a great sing because he was never like a father figure to me. He was like a friend to me. It's like always like so. We always like me and my dad. We feel the way of music we produce or we play, that is direct reflection from how we are behind the stage. Like if me and my father, if we have like a friendly relationship off stage and on stage, that helps a lot. It's like even when he's like, if looking at me, I feel like okay, you want some water? I got it. I'll get it to you. So it's like the looks and things. So on stage, when he plays this, oh yeah, I know now where you're going. And then, you know, like, so the understanding is really good when the understanding is good off stage. So we started doing this duo and we really enjoyed. I would say, like, the best person I ever played, I would say my father and grandfather, of course. But the thing me and my dad, we have, I really love that. I love to do that and we experiment with that. So that's how we started doing in concerts, and then he was doing this Kan Journey part one. Like his first album is just Kan Chira, nothing else, and different tarams he did. So then he said like the volume two, he wanted to do like a duo, me and my dad.
Do.
That's how this project Genymatic started. And sorry.
Yeah, no
Sorry, my
problem.
internet got cut. Yeah. So he said like, okay, let's do this duo in different like beats. Let's take different beats and you know like and if even if you see the behind background, it'll be like a harmonium era. So you know like a
Swami, I'm
synthesized
losing you at
harmonium
some
was to
point.
take it.
Can you just check your internet if it's okay? Sorry for the interruption, everyone. I'm sure he'll be joining soon. I think he's fixing his internet. Let's just hold on to listen more about the album. Okay, I'm getting a request again. Okay, I'm sure this will be better. Swami?
Hi. Yeah, I hope I'm back. And
Yeah,
you?
this is better.
Sounding good?
Yes,
Sorry for
it
that. I
is.
don't know what happened. So I got some
Oh,
network
no
issues
problem.
maybe.
Yeah.
So that's how the album started, you know, like and we sat together and we fixed some real like taking be different beats and doing playing around with the phrases and things. That's how it started. And we had some electronic backups behind happening to make it, you know, like really cool. And also like we focused on like not really electronic music, but you know, like contemporary classical, bringing the classical into that kind of a feel.
Lovely. It's a beautiful album. to actually listen to the balance, or the pan Indian, or world approach to using an instrument on a world stage, which also credits to your grandfather and to your dad for popularizing the tradition and also the instruments on such a big platform. Which also brings me to the next question, which is your hashtag play from home during the pandemic. You've collaborated with an entire spectrum of artists, and you've been so persistent with that effort to actually bring about. I remember every day I used to go check, okay, what's next from Chami? Is there a next video? Who is he collaborating with for the next time? I also saw collaborations with Vikuji, with so many artists, irrespective of which tradition, where they hail from, what music they follow. You've been taking the instrument to different stages, but also showing that you can collaborate with anyone from any place. Please tell me more about how you started that off and what inspired you to continue it for a pretty long time, in fact.
So 2020, that was like a rough year and difficult year for everyone. So me, my dad, my grandfather, my uncles, we went. I'm getting some issues. Sorry, can you hear me now? Okay.
Sorry.
So yeah, we were in tour in US on March 2020. We
Okay.
like hardly played two concerts, performed two concerts, and then this major breakdown came. And like, you remember like March 11th around that time,
Yeah.
21st, I think. Yeah. So India like closed doors for like foreign flights and things, everything, like the lockdown happened. So we managed somehow to send my grandfather and two other uncles to India with the last flight. There was like the last
Okay.
flight and we couldn't get more tickets. So we at least thought like, okay, at least these three people has to reach home safely. So they
Yeah.
went, and but my grandfather and one of my uncles, they got stuck in Mumbai. Like their flight was like from New York
Oh.
to Mumbai and from Mumbai to Chennai, but they couldn't catch that Mumbai to Chennai flight because of the, like we have to do that mandatory self-isolation quarantine. So they were stuck in Mumbai, and then for 1 month they couldn't move from there. So
Oh
Vikuji
my,
was
okay.
in like one place in Mumbai, locked down. After 1 month of staying there, he came by road, like in car. They came Chennai. Like it took 3 days, like stopping in Hampi and like in Gokarna and then Bangalore and then coming to Chennai. That's how they came from Mumbai. So me and my dad, we got locked up in New Jersey until July, until June,
Okay.
July times. So we were stuck totally over there. I didn't know, like it's lockdown and me and my dad were sitting inside the room and we don't know what to do. And that time I thought like, okay, let's start and do some collaborations. Like so many people are there and everyone is locked down now. And everyone has to do something, so they will be like have some time to like collaborate. So I just posted a video in my Insta and Facebook saying that okay, I'm here, I'm gonna do some collaborations while stuck here. So if whoever is interested in doing this, just ping me and let's do it. But I was so
Oh.
surprised to see so many responses to that. Like it was like wow, this many people wanted to do. And once I started doing it, I didn't know like I'm gonna do it every day. I thought like okay, someone will send it to me, I'll do it today and then like taking a break and working on what to do next, and we can do something 3 4 days after, like at least three videos per week. But I got like so many people played and sent it to me already, like I like 15 to 20 people already sent to me. I thought like okay, if I started doing this, I want to do this for a year, like if I do only for three or like two in a week or something like that. So I thought okay, let's do daily. Like so the
Wow.
work is like every day I wake up, I do all my usual daily things, routines, and then do puja and then sit in the computer. Okay, today I open. Okay, let me do this video. I record that and then I started editing, learning editing also at that point of time to place two people and syncing things. So that's how I started. So I started doing that. Each day I do that and then I post it in the night to US time, so it's like morning in Indian time. And this became a routine for 3 to 4 months.
Oh,
So I
wow.
was like super happy and I was like okay, this is good. And also I got a chance to play with people who I never played before, so it's like people from different parts of India. Once this play from started to heat up, like and a lot of people started watching it, liking it, so many people from different part of the world like sent requests to me. I said like yes, I'm gonna do this definitely, whoever it is I'm happy to do. And I got really great contacts and people who are like really great in their field, in their area, like their country. And also, I got chance to play with Gary Husband, who's amazing drummer
Wow,
cum pianist. And so I played with Gino and Tashin. So these are my
I saw
great
that.
friends and great people, and it was so amazing. And also, I got mentioned in New York Times paper for doing this play from home thing. So after
Wow.
50 episodes, they mentioned it okay, from New Jersey, this person is doing this, play from home collaborations with different part of people, and keeping this time point of time busy and also keeping mind fresh. See, the thing is, so many people suffered with mental issues also, not only the physical
Absolutely.
or health issues. They also had some mental breakdowns as well. For me, music kept me alive. I could, stuck in a room, just nothing. There's a shop next to my house, so I go there. We buy groceries every day, for like 3 4 for a week at least, and we buy it. And then we go. We don't go anywhere. We just sit in a room and play music and post it, and that's how it has been. Then we had a very bad thing happen. My grandma died in May, so we had to. Somehow have to manage to come there, but we couldn't come at the right time. We came a little late because we didn't have any flight. We came through that Air India's government's flight, which they rescue people from that. And I'm so thankful to Indian government and US government for doing that to us. They helped us. They understood the situation, and then they made some arrangements for us, and we came here. But after coming here, it was a little difficult for me to continue. That's how it stopped. But for the 3 months, it was amazing doing that. That kept me
No,
alive.
absolutely. Absolutely. Just about how you said how music heals people or music makes people feel better. This was an initiative which might have helped you, but it helped 1,000 others when you did the same, right? It's not the persistence and the commitment to doing that project. Hats off, Swami, for doing that. A lot of my friends collaborated. I didn't know exactly how the collaboration worked. I would have been so happy to have sent a video to you and collaborated at that point. I'm sorry I
I'm
missed that
really looking forward
opportunity.
to play with you sometime.
I'm same here, same here. Would be amazing to do that. Okay, that's in fact 40 minutes of conversation. I really did not know how the time went by. Meanwhile, can you also speak about the kind of projects and collaborations that you've been doing other than this and the concerts? Like, how did you start playing for concerts? What sort of music do you enjoy and what sort of concerts do you actually perform?
So basically, I enjoy music whichever has more opportunity or more interesting to play, or more tough job to do. I like to take challenge, I would say like that. I like to take a challenge. So of course, nothing can beat Carnatic or Indian classical music. It's like the best music all over the world. It's like if you I always felt like, since I'm being from Carnatic or Indian classical, I would say, background, so wherever I go, the music, wherever I hear, it's much easier to adapt. It's like whenever they play so immediately I change that into Konoko, so it's much easier to translate it into my form. And then when I play with them, they'll be like, oh wow, you got that in a few minutes. I said, no, it's definitely difficult music too, but since we are coming from Indian background, we can able to adapt that to our style and to reciprocate that. So challenging music are really amazing. And I played with different, I would say I played with jazz musicians, I played with Western classical musicians, and of course Carnatic, Hindustani, and different forms of music. Every music has its own pleasures and things. I can't say I can choose this genre, I want to just play this genre. It's like I'm a Carnatic musician who likes to collaborate with all kind of music and all kind of musicians.
Wow. And also because Viku sir, also your father have been people who are equally adept at Carnatic as well as world or global platform music with symphonies or orchestras or different bands, including Shakti and
True.
places like that,
That's one of
where
the major
you
inspiration for most of the people who do music, you
absolutely.
know. And
I
also
mean,
being growing up listening to that kind of music, oh my God,
yeah,
it's like a very powerful music. Like the name says, Shakti. It's
it
really a
is.
powerful music, and it inspired a lot. And you know, like that's the thing which kept me like looking for so many other things. Like it's like that's something which is new, unique in its own way, and it's a new of a kind. That's how
Yeah.
you know, like the fusion kind of started. They are the you know like people who say like these different musics can be played together as well. So it's like
Yeah.
that's the main inspiration since childhood. I felt like okay, I want to do something different, something more like that, and also inspiring like taking inspiration from that, we can you know like learn things and imply that in different forms and different things. And I also like in Play From Home there was one episode where I did a collaboration with the tap dancer. That was like, oh
Okay.
wow, that's another thing. Like I really loved that person. He's from Japan, so he did the tap dancing and he sent it to me, and then I was like, you know, collaborating over that. And we also did one live performance together in Japan before that. So Shakti was like a really great inspiration for me as well. Like, sorry to
Wow.
interrupt you. When you said Shakti, I couldn't like, you know, stop
No. I wanted to
talking.
exactly ask about that. How has influences from outside shaped your taste of playing and your taste of choosing, which project to be a part of? Because it's important to choose the right projects that let you grow and not
True.
let you stagnate. You have to push your comfort zone. Listening to Shakti always puts you out of the comfort zone because everything is challenging with Shakti, right? So
Exactly. And also the how Shakti, like my grandfather, he was supposed to be taking he was in working as an All India
I
Radio
saw, I'm
announcer.
sorry to interrupt, but I saw Rajesh sir just join somewhere. I mean, when we spoke about Shakti, to have Rajesh sir into the group was very amazing.
Some coincidence, yeah. Hi, no, thanks for joining us here.
Hi, sir.
So my grandfather, he was in All India Radio as like a temporary staff initially, and then he was offered to take permanent job in that. At the same time, he got the offer to play in Shakti, and you know it was something new of a kind. And people like who he used to play with all like say like no, don't do that, don't go there and play. You are getting a permanent job here, you will miss that. It's a government job, Sarkar job. If you go there, you would lose this. And then they say like if you go there, you can't play in proper Carnatic music, like Sampradayam music. Carnatic music is like very Sampradayam traditional music. If you go and play in that, you can't be play here. We won't allow you to play here. Hi, Inna.
Namaste, Rajesh sir. Also saw hi
So
from Ish. Ishan. Hi, Ishan.
hi,
Please,
good
please
morning.
continue.
So everyone said you know like was opposed to that, like they said like you can't go, you don't have to do. But my grandfather listened only to one person, which is his father, Thettakudi Hariharan Sharma. So he asked him what should he do. So my great grandfather, he said, if you want to like take the Ghatam to next stage, like if you want to be like a Pandit Ravishankar who took sitar and traveled all around, if you want to become like that, you have to go into Shakti. But if you go there, you have to be like fully focused on that. You can't miss family. Anyway, he was supposed to be go there for 6 months just to rehearse and practice. So he said, if you go there, you have to be focused into music, and you have to forget about the family, and you have to work hard on that. Or else you can be here, you will be like a Ghatam artist in Chennai in All India Radio, and then you'll be like that forever. So my then that time, so my grandfather had a courage to you know like say whatever people are against, like against of that, he went into that. He was like fully focused, and he gave himself to that, and he got amazing people, amazing musicians with him. And so listening to all those stories, it's very inspired to me that I have to do things out of my comfort zone as well, and also like should be very strong and courageous to do different, try out different things, even though some people might not think that's good. But if it is like you feel like okay, your heart says you want to do this, just do it and go for it.
Very, very strong lessons that you can look at and learn from, in your family itself. Which is amazing. Thanks for sharing that story. I've never known about how this happened. I've seen a couple of videos where Zakir Ji was sitting with Viku Ji for the first time he met John McLaughlin, I think in Bangalore or sorry, Bombay or somewhere. In a terrace, there's a video that has been put out. So, yeah. And would you like to share about any projects that you've been working out recently with, or any projects that have been very interesting through your journey? I mean, we spoke about the duo, we spoke about the tap dancer. Any special project that, yeah.
So I'm like working with a Turkey musician. So he has like an instrument like looks like santu, but it's not like santu, but like a string, and it's like
Kanun.
very beautiful. Exactly, kanun. Kanun. Like I really loved that, and I did a project with him. Like he played in the Play From Home series with me, and then he wanted me
Oh,
to work in
okay.
one of his project. So I did a song like with him, and it is like,
Amazing.
you know, they had the pandeira and other things also in that song. So it was so interesting to collaborate with that, and I got my own space to do, you know, like blend the Carnatic into that, and that project was interesting. And like recently I released a song with Siddharth. You've seen
Yeah,
a full
it was a
concert stage in
beautiful,
Bangalore.
beautiful
Yeah.
song for Shivaratri, right?
Right. I mean, like
Beautiful
it was
song.
supposed to be released on Shivratri, but it got delayed,
Okay.
and we had some other corrections to do it, and we got released it later. But that's like one of a very powerful song, like very heart-touching song for me. And also, I'm trying to come up with an album, like you know, collaborating. What it's about? It's like the Play From Home thing, like the world music with different musicians collaborating to put it in like one album. So I'm working on that now. I'm really interested in that and looking forward. That and to give you all the different genres and different kinds of sounds.
Amazing, amazing. I would also love to know more about one thing. How your grandfather, as well as your father, they've been choosing the way of playing, like the style of their playing, or the how they appease the audiences, not just by playing the most intricate stuff, but also by playing complex stuff in a very presentable form. Like for example, you know this shlokam in terms of how the konnakol and the shlokam go together, composing hymns in praise of you know Mahaperiyava or about God, or in terms of konnakol and things like that. It reaches to millions of people, but it also goes along with the rhythm and the intricate part of it. How are you care? I mean, how are you inspired by that style as well? And what is have yeah
Sure.
about your
So,
own style and how you look at it.
yeah. So before everything, like the first you asked me, like how like my grandfather like do complex stuff also and make it like you know work better with the audience. So my
Yeah.
tata always says the key word is like he says in Tamil like chinnadu perisu, like you know the dynamics.
Oh,
So when you
okay.
play it, you have to know where you have to hit hard and where you have to be like soft. So the dynamics. I always remember that he says like chinnadu perisu. You can't like play like. No, straight throughout the thing. You have to be like the wave should be like this, like the dynamics should be like that. So dynamics is the key. He says like
Wow.
whatever you play, like if you play it in a right dynamic and right tone, that will be amazing. So that's the
Yeah.
thing. And coming to the shloka part, so my grandfather, he wanted to take shlokas on Kanchi Mahaperivar written by his uncle Kavi Chakravarti Vairinatha Sharma. So he
Okay.
wrote on Mahaperivar like different lot of poets and things. So my tata want to take all those shlokas and somehow want to do it in a concert in a way like it is very rhythmic. So the first shloka he did was Arindu Mariyamalum Therindu Seriyamalum. So all the poet has some kind of meter, like default meter in it. We just have to find the right meter what it is. So Arindu Mariyamalum tata said it like it sounds like you know like a five. So he did with Kandachaba like Arindu Mariyamalum Therindu Seriyamalum Makita Takatong Katong Vikita Takatong Kata Tey the Sakala Putrangalagum Pavangalagum Nikila Shitkajit Yamak Nikchayamni Arunavendum. So he took the you know like the sloka and then he gave some syllables to that like arindu mariyamulum it goes like this takita takatom katom dikita takatom katom takita dikita ta ta tinna tum din din gena tum dam dam tin tin tum tum takita din da din ta takita din ta takita takita ta ta din gena tum ta da kata da kata ta kata arindu mariya allu tin seri ya allu seida sagala kutrangalagi pavangalagi manni rakshit ka git yamak nitta yam ni haru labe nuru danda shi maha seri yam charanam 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 ta So that's the first sloka.
Thank
he
you.
Took it, and then he wanted someone to recite that so that he can play and then together. Initially, he was reciting and he was playing and doing, and then later he's like, okay, he called me and then he said, I'm going to teach you this sloka. Come and sit and play with me. So he started to teach that sloka, and then I was doing, and then he was just playing it on katam, and then we both were doing together. And he said, like, okay, this is the new concert. I'm going to work on it. And that's when, so my tata had a group called Saptakshwara with all my, I mean, my dad, my uncles and other uncles.
Yeah.
So it was like one family group. And then he wanted to do something just with slokas. So he chose me and I was so lucky to be the one. So he taught me all the slokas and then we were sitting and like me, my dad, my grandfather, my uncle, we all were sitting together and making it into like a piece, like a song.
Oh.
So there'll be like some kind of intro to that, and then the sloka verses, and then coming back to konnakol or kanjira, different instruments, we gave different sounds, and we created like a song. So we had created like 10 songs of different slokas and different talams. Also, not only like normal beats, also like 7.5, taking, you know, like 1.5 as a thing, 7.5, 8.5, 9.5. So he was working on all those things. And then we created like a concert without any melody. This, like, he wanted to do something just with slokas. And this is started because, like, he wanted to establish the slokas that his uncle wrote on Kanchi Mahapiriva. So, you know, like, to those stuff, we don't want to that to get extinct. To revive that, we started doing this and I enjoyed doing that. And I was so lucky I was the one he chose to do the slokas.
Wow.
That's
great. Well, I don't know what more to ask because there's so much to process already through the conversation. Also, do you play other percussions, any other percussions that you're interested in? Because I've seen Selvaji has an entire percussion kit, an amazing kit that he has played with. And that it's the way he sits and plays those kit and how he controls them.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. How has been your tryst with percussions other than kanjira?
You know, like since I just played with single handed, it was very difficult for me to go with double handed instruments initially.
Okay.
It was like a different stage. I didn't have much, I'm not much stronger in left. I just like, you know, like playing all my life like this. But I started to adapt playing it. Like, you know, there's a proper way of doing something. And there is a way which you can do it and looks like it's proper. You know, like you can create a sound. So basically it's like you wanted to create a sound. I enjoy myself playing. So I play ganjira traditionally and also like in my own way. But other instrument, I just adapt and play. Like, you know, when we play, you know, when we learn something, we can adapt that to different things. We just...
Absolutely.
We just have...
Chami,
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Sorry for that. So, like when you learn little techniques of how to play any instrument, you can just adapt whatever you know and you learned in one instrument, you can adapt that to do that. So,
yeah.
I also play like little bit of jambe, kahun, and mosing, gatam, and also mridangam. It's like, you know, but not in a proper way how it has to be played, but still.
Wow, very interesting. And, yeah, and if ever you get a chance to play Gappu, I don't know if you know more about the company that makes cajons and other percussions as well. So if you ever get a chance, have you tried their cajons or any percussion yet? Chami, were you able to listen to me?
Can you hear me? Sorry.
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Can you hear me? Yeah, okay, perfect. So I was in this one concert and like one of my friend gave me the, you know, Gappu Kahun.
Okay.
And it was really comfortable and nice to play with it, but I didn't have a chance to, you know, like work more on it. but I really
Okay.
look forward to get something and play over it. But that the which one my friend had, it was really good and nice.
Okay, great. I mean, just to know if you've tried the instrument, and because I've been using it as well, so great.
I heard you playing that. It really sounded great. Of course, it's from your hands
Oh,
too.
okay. Thank you so much. Which I think brings to the end of our conversation. It's almost 1 hour, and I did not know the time passed by.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your time and sharing such amazing knowledge about Kanjira, the instrument that a lot of people do not yet know, and also a lot of information that I personally did not know at all about the instrument and the technique and your entire lineage, how you grew up and became this amazing percussionist that you are. I would also want to end the conversation with two things. One, what are your aspirations? Whom are you looking forward to performing with? Any role models or any giant musicians that you're looking forward to working at some point of your lifetime? One, and can we conclude with you playing the Kanjira? That will be an amazing conclusion for us.
Sure, definitely. I mean, like recent times I've been working more with Mandolin Rajeshji, Veena
Wow.
Rajeshji and things, and they are amazing musicians,
Of course,
great
of course.
musicians to play with. And also like I've been pretty much played with a lot of people, and it's always like a pleasure to do share stage with any musicians. Like everyone is great in their own kind of ways. I would never love to, I mean, like I would never try to compare anyone with anything. It's like everyone has their own style. Some has like they can't, no one can play the speed they play. Someone can't like take the like the sweetness like them. So everyone has their own kind of feel and great. And I'm really looking forward to work with musicians I've not worked before, and also different kinds of genres and different kinds of sounds which I've not worked before. I'm always like in a search for like something new. And definitely, of course, to play with any like big artists like Zakir Hussain G, or like anyone like who's like that standard is like will be the greatest day of my life. And also shared like two three stages with him. It was so amazing. He was so kind. And like one concert I would never forget is in Pune, where like we were supposed to do like me, my father and my grandfather, we were supposed to play in like the first part of the concert, and then second part of the concert Zakir ji was supposed to do it, and the program got delayed to because of some recent technical issues. The program delayed, so Zakir ji said like let's all play together, why should we play like that's the first time I'm gonna sit with him. I was like so nervous, and like oh my God, in front of so it's like 5,000 people over there in Pune. And then I was like, okay, this is like a dream come true time, but also I'm a little nervous and things. But he said like so my ta like that we were supposed to, we don't know how we're gonna sit. So Zaki ji said, Bikuji, you sit on the right hand side, like in the middle place. And say, I'm like my father, he told him to sit this side. He said, you come and sit next to me. I was like, what? Is
Wow.
this for real? Oh my God. He made me so comfortable. He said, like, come sit next to me. I've been sitting with these people for so long time, and I want to sit with you once. I was like, oh my God, is this for real? I just like, okay, this is for real only. And then like we started to, I don't know where to play eventually, but he made me very comfortable, and then he gave me space to do my thing. And then like we had a sawal jawab, and then he asked me to play it, and it was, oh my God, unforgettable concert. It's so great.
Oh, amazing,
And
amazing.
so before concluding this discussion with my Kanchira performance, I would like to thank Gopinath for having me in this series. And like you said, I didn't even know it was like 1 hour past. You have been so nice and sweet, and thank you so much for like having this conversation with me. And it's so nice. I've
Thank
been
you, thank
following
you.
your projects and things, Kriya. I'm very happy for that, and then I give you like
Thank you.
wish big success for that. And so thank you so much. So I'm just gonna play a little bit,
Thank you so much, Seva. Very, very
and
kind of you.
I'll do my favorite chord way, which is like 3-6-3-5-3-4-3-2, and then like takkadum 3 times. It's like it's one of our favorite chord. Me and my dad, we always like play that. So I'll play it in
Okay,
the blue,
please,
and then
please.
I go to that.
Sure.
Thank you so much. This is like a festival season ending with a blast, you know. Thank you so much, Swami. Such a delight having you. And wow, I'm so happy and blessed that I got the opportunity to do this with you.
I'm so
Thanks to
happy
Gappu
to be doing
again.
with this you. Yes.
Thank you. Thanks again, Gappu. Thanks to all the people who have been viewing, putting down your comments, watching the entire session. It's Swaminathan with us and winding up today's percussion discussion. See you probably next week or the next week with an amazing guest again. So thank you again, Swami. It's having Swami with us, you know, with the instrument, with the divine percussion and rhythm. Thank you so much for joining us. Please convey our regards, my personal regards to your father, to your entire family. I'm so blessed to be having this with you today.
Sure.
So see you all and bye. Take care, Swami. Good night.
Bye. Good night. Thank you.